All right, so this is lesson two of chapter eight, and so this is the second half. We left the first video by asking you to research some products in your home. So please put your findings in your notes package for when you hand that in. I'd like to see what you found. This is what this is all about. It's sort of our exposure to hazardous materials. So see what you might be able to find in some inconspicuous places around your house and where you live. So let's continue. Hazardous wastes also come from medical facilities. Waste that includes blood products, body organs, old medicines, used swabs and bandages. And I think I'm frozen there still. Needles, syringes are some examples. So you can imagine, especially when you talk about blood products and body organs, I mean, you know, I have an organ transplant or something like that. Like, you know, what happens to these things? You don't just throw them in the garbage, you know, in the cafeteria. What happens? Especially if we have disease ridden, like if we're talking about tumors or things that are removed, you know, how do these get dealt with? And there would be lots of restrictions and regulations, but there are strict regulations regarding this biohazardous waste. So remember, when we talk about hazardous, you know, can be harmful, and bio is have to do with living things, right? So it's living tissue, like that's mentioned there. Yeah, sharps and syringes and all that sort of stuff. So hospitalized that specialize in nuclear medicine procedures also have to be careful with radioactive waste, as you can imagine. Radiation treatments and different nuclear medical treatments. There's going to be some very hazardous waste that they'll have to consider as well. Factors that determine the nature and severity of health effects are this. There are four main factors. Toxicity is how harmful a substance or waste is, how toxic it is, how damaging it could be. Duration is how long a person is exposed to this hazardous material. The amount of exposure, so it's the severity, the duration, the amount, and the route of exposure, okay, whether it's inhaled or ingested, absorbed through the skin. Obviously, if something dangerous is inhaled, it goes right to your lungs, right into your bloodstream. If you touch something, maybe that's hazardous, it, your skin absorbs a portion of it, but it might not be as dangerous. So these are the four things. We're going to watch a short video here now on OSHA, Occupational Safety and Health Association biohazardous waste standard. So we'll watch a video here now. Okay, so a little info about what hospitals, dental offices, healthcare centers need to go through to dispose of hazardous waste, biohazardous waste, sharps containers. So if you've heard of OSHA, that's the Safety, Health and Safety Association. And I think that might be a little more American than Canadian, but standards are similar. Any questions? All right, page 251, mini activity 8.2. If you have your textbook, please open up to that page. So what I want you guys to be working on the next little bit here is to monitor media sources for news about hazardous waste. We watched a video yesterday, right, about the train derailment. That would be an example. You can't use that one, but you look for other news stories or media sources, articles, videos, that talk about hazardous waste, either a problem or a plan for a new facility or, some new science regarding, hazardous waste exposure or whatever. Choose a news story that interests you make notes on the main points of the story, evaluate the short-term and long-term effects of this waste or waste-related event, and be prepared to present your findings in class. So this can also be part of your poster project for this month. So don't forget, this could be one of the articles or news stories that you read about or study for your poster for this month, which is due at the end of next week, I believe, toward the last Friday of the month. So this is something that you can start after we're finished this lesson. We'll give you some time to do that. So not exactly right now, but this is just coming up here, okay? So news related event regarding hazardous waste. Okay, any questions? I'll let you know about a due date here soon. I think I have a due date set on Edsby already, but. So section 8.2, we'll finish this last section, and like I say, then you get a chance to research that one if you want this class yet. So managing hazardous waste. Environment Canada suggests 4 main actions to reduce hazardous waste. We reduce the amount of waste at its source. Recycle waste whenever possible. Treat waste to reduce its hazard or volume. As a last resort, dispose of waste at hazardous waste landfills or incinerate them. Okay. So, we've heard lots about recycling. We've learned about incineration here recently. Reduce the amount of waste at a source, okay? So in the packaging even, or in the, in the manufacturing process. And then treat waste to reduce its hazard or volume. We touched on that a little bit as well, right? Chemicals or filtration or whatever to reduce the hazard components of the waste. So if you treat it before you release it back into the waste stream, then that's going to help too. Okay, so another assignment that's part of your notes here. Research how a household can safely dispose of hazardous waste in your city. Record your findings of the space below. So you'll have a little bit of research to do here for this chapter. This one is, just about how regular citizens, we're not talking about hospitals, we're talking about, we're talking about businesses, we're talking about just regular citizens. What happens if you have hazardous waste material that's generated in your house? For example, if you change your own oil in your garage, what do you do with that oil? Where does that go? How do you get rid of that? Is it okay to dump it down the storm drain? No. Is it okay to pour it down the toilet? No. What are you supposed to do with it? So that's what I want you to research, and that's just one example. If you have sharps or broken glass, or if you have, used engine oil or biohazardous material that comes up in your house, what can you do about it and what should you do about it? So look at the regulations in our city and find out if there's deposit stations or if there's a certain way that, bylaws say that you're supposed to deal with hazardous waste. Okay, and that'll be should be a quick internet search about what happens in our city. All right, types of hazardous waste treatment. As we mentioned before, chemical treatment can turn hazardous waste into less hazardous substances through chemical reactions. Okay, so if you chemically treat it, a chemical reaction may yield products that are quite a bit less dangerous than the original reactants. Physical force or mechanical devices can reduce physical waste simply by volume if you're crushing something. Also, another example would be filters that remove hazardous substances from liquid waste, or a trash compactor may physically reduce the volume. So we're going to talk lots more about filters and stuff when we talk about waste. Filtration is really important. So biological bioremediation involves using microorganisms to remove certain levels of contaminants. So if microorganisms can break down harmful things into less harmful things or use them for good, then that's a way of treating the waste. Bioremediation. So again, bio is living organisms. Remediation is kind of like going back and fixing things. That's kind of like what the remediation means. Going back and addressing concerns. Preparing better for the future. All right, also thermal. So we talked a lot about this last chapter, I think. Exposing hazardous waste to extreme heat may reduce its volume if toxic gases can be controlled. So I won't talk too much more about that. We've talked about this already. Immobilization, okay, this is interesting. Hazardous waste can be trapped in glass, ceramics, or cement, where they can be stored without threatening the environment. So you think about, this happens actually quite a bit, where hazardous waste is trapped in cement or, where it literally can't escape and harm anybody. It's still hazardous, but it's trapped. It's immobilized. It's rendered ineffective by its placement, which is kind of interesting, right? I guess it would be kind of like a jail for dangerous people. If people are dangerous to the society, they're immobilized by put them in jail. They're still dangerous, but they're not going to hurt anybody because they're in jail, or at least nobody outside of jail. Precipitation. Okay, I think this is the last one. It's also called flocculation, which is a great word. I don't know why. It's just a great word. This approach is used mostly for treating sewage. It binds hazardous components to chemicals that can be physically removed. So if you have some biohazardous material floating around, you put in the chemical called the flocculant, then what happens is they bind together or bind to the chemical and become clumpy sort of thing, and then you can filter that out a little bit easier. So you may have particles that are too small to be filtered, but if they're, a million clumps of them, then that's big enough to be filtered out, and you can grab them out all at once. So that's what that is. And that's part of, a sewage treatment, like we said. Okay, any questions? All right. Methods of disposal of hazardous waste include deep well injection. So that's a type of immobilization, right? Just send it down deep and underground where it's not going to, harm anybody. Or hazardous waste landfills, which we talked a little bit about already, which are like regular landfills, but with added environmental protection. And this is just a little diagram I found online. It looks like a regular landfill, right? But there's some added protection, maybe more layers as a boundary here. Biohazardous waste drums, so an extra layer. They don't just dump it all in there so it reacts together, but they keep them separated, but it's still underground and so on. And so lots of monitoring, monitoring wells and that kind of thing. Leachate collection pipes that can pump the any liquid stuff to the surface. And then finally, one more, I think this is the last one, retrievable storage. So retrievable storage is a type of permanent storage with the option of retrieving the material if safer disposal technologies are invented. So basically, you would put this in a building that you just leave it in there and don't ever touch, in case unless something happens where you can bring it out and render it less harmful, or in a cave or an abandoned mine or something. Lots of times, this is a type of permanent storage, but it is retrievable. So if something happens over time where, hey, we can use this stuff or we can dispose of it better, then you can actually mobilize it and do something with it, right? So it's a type of permanent storage, but it is retrievable. Okay. All right. So that's the end of Chapter 8 material. You do have a couple assignments that I had mentioned in the notes already, and here are your assignment questions as well. To work on, to review some of this material from Chapter 8. And of course, I do require you to read through the material in the textbook as well. I know it's not a lot of fun maybe to read the material, but there's lots of diagrams and charts and things in there that I couldn't include in your brief sort of summary notes here. But this is just the highlights. So please be reading the textbook as well. So now that we're at the end of Chapter 8, read, do the questions, and you can work on your assignments, which include researching some products at home, doing some online research, and so on. Okay? So this is the end of Chapter 8. Questions, assignments in the notes, and also your poster project and things like that. that you can work on for the rest of this class. Okay, any questions? There is a test upcoming. Yeah, you have a unit test upcoming. I can talk about that in a bit. You bet.
That was easy.
That was easy.
That was easy.